Hey, what's up, everybody? In this video, we're going to talk about elements and compounds at the atomic and molecular level. So this is a picture of a sample of pure elemental phosphorus. And suppose we had like a super sensitive microscope, and we were able to zoom in on this phosphorus until we could actually see the individual phosphorus atoms themselves. Well, what would we find? Well, in the case of phosphorus, we would find something that looks like this. Well, we would see many of these, but this would be the basic unit that we would see. And notice that elemental phosphorus is actually composed of these groups of four phosphorus atoms. And notice how these four atoms are oriented. They sit at the corners of a shape called a tetrahedron. And a tetrahedron is basically a four-sided geometric shape that has triangular faces. So that's what we're going to talk about in this video. We're going to talk about elements and compounds, what they look like, how they're arranged at the atomic level in the case of elements, and also at the molecular level in the case of compounds. So I think a good place to start in this discussion would be to talk about elements. And there are basically two main flavors of elements in this context, and those are atomic elements and molecular elements. And starting with atomic elements, these are the elements which exist with single atoms as their basic units. So potassium, for instance, is an atomic element. Pure potassium is composed of individual potassium atoms. Pure krypton is composed of individual krypton atoms, and so on and so forth. And this applies to most elements. Most elements are atomic elements, but then we also have some elements that don't exist with single atoms as their basic units, and we call these molecular elements. Instead of ex existing as single atoms, molecular elements actually exist as molecules. They exist as groups of two or more atoms covalently bonded together. And for instance, there are diatomic elements, and diatomic elements actually exist as molecules, and each of those molecules contains two atoms of the element. So they exist in pairs, basically. And in addition, we also have polyatomic elements, which exist as molecules that contain more than two atoms. So as we look at this periodic table here, well, all of the elements that are shaded in white, all of these are atomic elements. So here we can clearly see that the hefty majority of the elements in our periodic table exist with single atoms as their basic units. They're atomic elements. The elements that are shaded in orange are diatomic. Hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine, these are all diatomic elements. Instead of existing as single atoms, they exist as pairs of atoms. So that's why you often see a subscript next to their chemical symbols. So that's why you often see H2 gas or O2 and so forth. And then finally, the elements that are shaded in green, these are the polyatomic elements. So phosphorus is an example that we saw a moment ago. It is found in groups of four phosphorus atoms. Sulfur is an interesting one because sulfur actually forms these rings of eight sulfur atoms. So that's pretty interesting stuff. So there's basically atomic and molecular elements in a nutshell. And now I'd like to switch gears a little bit and talk about compounds. And there are two main flavors of compounds as well, and those are ionic and molecular compounds. So if you've seen my video on ionic and covalent bonds, then this might seem a little redundant, and I apologize, but nevertheless, I feel like we need to make sure that we have things right in terms of how these compounds are arranged. So let's start with ionic compounds. Now, ionic compounds consist of cations and anions, which are the positively and negatively charged ions, respectively. And those cations and anions are held together by ionic bonds. And what are these ionic bonds? Well, these ionic bonds are non-directional electrostatic interactions. So what the heck does that mean? Well, what I mean by that is that there's no specific cation that pairs with a specific anion. Instead, we have each cation surrounded by anions, and then each anion is also surrounded by cations, and the resulting structure is what we call a lattice. So a lattice is a repeating three-dimensional array. It's sort of like a cage, if you will, of interlocking cations and anions arranged in a very specific way. And these ions could be monoatomic, which means that they have one atom, or they could also be polyatomic ions. A polyatomic ion is basically like a molecule, but it has a charge. So This is actually a picture of the crystal structure of the ionic compound calcium carbonate. And notice here that we have a specific orientation where like I said, each cation is surrounded by anions, and each anion is surrounded by cations. So these blue things, these are the calcium ions, the Ca2 plus ions. And then these molecule looking things right here, these are called carbonate anions. They consist of a carbon atom in the middle, and that carbon atom is bonded to three oxygen atoms, and the whole ion altogether carries a negative 2 charge, which neutralizes the positive 2 charge of the calcium ions. So this is how ionic and molecular, this is how ionic compounds work. And I think this is very important, because this is very different from what we see with molecular compounds. With molecular compounds, we see individual molecules, but with these ionic compounds, we see these lattices, these large cages of alternating cations and anions, and that's why ionic compounds tend to be solids. So there's ionic compounds, but then we also have molecular compounds, and like I said earlier, these actually exist as discrete molecules. And the reason why they do that is because the atoms are sharing electrons with one another to form these molecules. So one example of a molecular compound would be acetone. Notice that each atom has a specific number of atoms that it bonds to. This is very different from ionic compounds. Instead of having a repeating lattice in the case of molecular compounds such as acetone, we just have a bunch of entities that look just like this. We have a bunch of individual molecules. And certainly there could be, you know, there definitely are forces that are present between those molecules, but they're not nearly as strong as the ionic bonds, as the forces that hold those cations and anions together in the ionic compounds. So like I said, if you've seen my video on ionic and molecular compounds, this might appear redundant, but it definitely is important that we're all on the same page and we all understand that. So all right, that's pretty much it for this video. Hope it was helpful, and all right, take it easy.